really enjoy being there this afternoon and sharing with you all the results we had recently about from the exploration of natural rocks from the oceanic crust. I would like to thank you for the invitation, and I would take this occasion to thank all my collaborators that have worked with me these last, I would say, 10 years on such kind of problems. So it concerned people, and in particular Muriel Andréani from the Laboratory of Geology of Lyon in France, and also colleagues from the Modena University in Italy. So I would like just to briefly introduce my talk. I would like to start with this view of the Archean surface, which is as depicted here, which was probably very hostile, and that's why people, since some years, are more and more looking deeper in the subsurface as a more quiet places where life could have emerged and evolved, and far from all these meteoric bombardments, but also all these deleterious irradiations. And when we talk about life in the subsurface, considering it as a possible hatchery for life, then it implies that organic molecules that could be at the origin of all the prebiotic chemistry could have been seeded on Earth by prebiotic materials. But alternatively, we wonder if Earth had its own potential for prebiotic chemistry. And I will really focus on that question today. And I could have entitled my talk previously with the question, what can we learn from the natural systems on this, on the potential of the Earth to form all these kind of abiotic organic compounds. So let's look at a natural system, and in particular, as Jill has introduced it, let's look at rocks forming the solid Earth, and in particular, the oceanic one. Most of my talk, and it was previously introduced by Jill, will focus on rocks that were collected below the Atlantis Massif, the massif which is hosted the famous Lost City hydrothermal vent. And Jill has already introduced the potential of this such kind of hydrothermal circulation to promote abiotic synthesis of organic compounds. This site hosts on ultramafic basements and derived from the serpentinization of rock from the substratum. And since in discovery during the early 2000 years, then it has really promoted a huge research because it was unlike any environment. It has changed a view about the conditions under which life can thrive on a planet, but perhaps elsewhere on Earth. The reason why, and it was well introduced in the previous talk, the reason why we look at those systems really into details is due to its potential to form hydrogen following the hydrations of the rock-forming minerals. And as a consequence of this reaction, if these hydrogens have the possibility to combine with oxidized carbon species, then we can start some interesting abiotic organic synthesis. And I don't know why this one is automatically moving. But we can start all this kind of reaction. And the one that were the most studied this last year were the Fischer-Tropsch type reaction and the Sabatier one, turning CO2 into methane. So we have proofs for the formation of methane formates and short-chain alkanes in such kind of environments. And as it was well synthesized previously by Gilles, then since many years, hydrothermal sites were considered as open system or open windows on the dynamic of serpentinization and on the associated deep carbon cycles. But can we really see well through this window? And I would like to just go deeper and draw your attention of what could happen when we look at depths and even at few kilometer depths when the serpentinization reaction starts at high temperature and as soon as the water meets iron-bearing minerals forming the mantle rock, then this hydrogen can form. And then you start to have in all the fractures and folds that are forming the oceanic crust, you can start such kind of abiotic carbon reduction reactions. As soon as you reach the limit that allow life to be there, then all this carbon reduction can then be biologically driven, and you can have the overprint of both type of process up to their release at the level of hydrothermal vents. All these products can also be recycled, abiotic compound being used by biological activity, but also maybe the metabolic biological byproducts can be then involved in other organic synthesis reaction. So this is why the system can be highly complex, but it also highlights that the chemical disequilibria that can be the forerunners for the organic synthesis can start deep in the crust. And if we are able to look into detail at what happened there, then maybe we can provide clues on all these kind of processes. So this is a strategy we have used these last years and trying to assess the diversity of organic compounds by looking at the host rocks at the microscales and all the results you will see in the slide that will follow is based on what we call correlative microscopy. The aim is to use different kinds of microscopy and to merge them to be able to accumulate proof of what happened within the rocks. So the first example I would like to show you some results on are rocks that derive from oceanic drilling, because oceanic drilling is a way to access to deep serpentinized mantle rocks. And so the drilling we worked a lot on this last year is the rock that we are drilling during IODP Expedition 304 that drilled the hole 1309D. And I will focus the first part of my talk on serpentinite that were drilled at around 200 meters below seafloor. And here you can see an optical view of these rocks that show you that it resembles to regular serpentinized albergite with high temperature serpentinite that is cross-cut by magnetite that derives from the serpentinization reactions. And then at the core of the mesh in those rocks, we have found the presence of secondary minerals, and their orange to brown color can tell you that those secondary minerals are iron-rich mineral phases. So we first tried to assess and evaluate if those rocks were containing organic compounds, and one of favorite first steps is to do some Fourier transform infrared microscopy images that allow to highlight at a large scale where the organic compounds can be found. So here you can see some imaging of the carbonic functional groups and also the aliphatic moieties of the region here highlighted by the red rectangles. And what you can see is that all these organic signals is particularly is closely related to the occurrences of the hydrant-rich mineral phases. So it allows us to make some more focused study at higher resolution, including the use of synchrotron deep UV fluorescences. So here you recognize some of the sample we looked at during using Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy. And in the regions here where the organic compounds were found using Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy, then we have highlighted the presence of deep UV fluorescences. And this fluorescence was heterogeneously distributed within the secondary mineral phases. And in brown, you can see the spectral signal that was displayed in the area with the highest fluorescent signals. Compared to what happened in the Buhlt serpentinite, here with really a depict as baselines, then this fluorescence emerged from the cell fluorescence of aromatic organic compounds that were identified as tryptophan, as you can see here, and also as indoled and other aromatic organic compounds that could be either a degradation product of tryptophan, but also some precursors of these amino acids. Just for your information, you can see the fluorescent signal that emerged from tryptophan when it's associated with biological cells. And as fluorescence, deep fluorescence spectroscopy really depends on the local environment of the molecule, then both signals can be easily differentiated. Here it's a tryptophan associated with proteins, and here we concluded that it's related to isolated molecules of tryptophanes. So deep UV fluorescence is not by itself a proof for the presence of an organic compound. So this is why we further investigated all these compounds using another kind of microscopy techniques, which is tough seams imaging, and that allows you to recover all the organic and inorganic fragments that are forming your samples, and you can investigate it at depths of a few tens of nanometers. So tough seams imaging, as you can see here, have allowed us to locate the region of interest, which is rich in iron. This is what you can see here in greens. And it's also allowed to confirm that the tryptophan was co-localized with the presence of this iron-rich secondary mineral phases. So by here you can see the mass fragment that is a characteristic of this amino acid. And by co-localizing all the organic fragment we are expecting from tryptophan, then we were able to confirm the nature of these organic compounds. So we then, as I have illustrated it in my previous slides, we have accumulated different kind of proof and evidence that supported the abiotic formation of this amino acid within the rocks of the Atlantis Massif at depths. And some of them are listed here because we had to prove that it was not amino acid that were formed and related to remnant ecosystem that were living in the rock at some times, or that they were not debris from the adsorption of amino acid that could have been sorbed at the surface of the clay we were looking at. So based on the fact that not all clays have organic compounds at the rock and the sample scale, so that this was assessed by the Fourier transform imaging we have done at large scale, allowing to correlate minerals with organics, based also on the fact that tryptophan and associated acid aminos were not randomly distributed and specifically associated with this iron-rich serpentine and saponite phase. Based also on the fact that no traces of fracture fields with those organic were cross-cutting the samples, telling us that it could have been input from water circulations. Based also on the fact that we had spatially homogeneous signatures throughout the study samples, and by comparison, a biological signal show you very diverse organic signature at the micrometric scales. And finally, based on the fact that spectral signature were really highly different from biological improves, and on the fact that we did not find any conventional biomarker by mass spectroscopy measurement, then we conclude on the abiotic origin of this amino acid. I already show you how deep UV fluorescence signature were highly different from tryptophan with the biological origins. This is an example of the clues we have accumulated based on TOF-SIMS imaging. Here you can see details on the mass spectra we have collected, showing you that really all the compounds we have found are really low mass compounds. And at the places where all conventional biomarkers are expected, then all the spectra were really flat. So we then try to understand and explain the occurrences of this tryptophan at the level of the iron-rich mineral phases. And here you can see how electron microscopy was really useful in that perspective. So you recognize the optical images showing you the accumulation and the fluorescent signal characteristic of tryptophan. So here, this is the corresponding image you obtain using scanning electron microscopy. Such kind of image first allow us to recognize not only by its textural characteristics, but also we use electron microprobe analysis to determine that it was saponite. But already at the micrometric level within the saponites, we had some heterogeneous distribution of the organic carbon phase. Here it's highly recognizable when you look at the gray level of the image, the dark black color telling you that carbon is enriched in that saponite compared to these regions where you have a lower level of organic compounds. So what does that mean? What does this heterogeneous distribution of organic compounds mean within the saponites? Then to better understand that, we did some focused ion beam sectioning of all the area that were enriched in carbons and that were displaying signal for amino acids. So here you can see the section, and then it allows you to perform some transmission electron microscopy imaging. Here you can see some of the observation we have done at the micrometric scales on the section that were cut on the samples. And what you can observe compared to what can be expected from a normal phyllosilicate that is made of a regular and parallel silicate layer. Here we observe that all the silica layers that were forming the saponite were highly disordered, showing us a house of cards structure with pores of various sizes, from the mesopore to larger pore, but also nanometric pores. So based on this observation, and also on the well-recognized property of iron saponite, which is a tetrahedrally charged trioctoidal smectite, that when it contains both iron-2 and iron-3 as an enhanced surface acidity and is, based on that reason, a well-known acid catalyst with high adsorption, swelling, and cation exchange capacity. And this enables these phyllosilicates to form what we call pillared structures. So here you can see a schematic of a normal saponites. And if you put some large ion, it can be organic or inorganic ion, then this ion start to structure and distort the, all the layer, but also can enhance the catalytic property of your clays. And so we postulate that all these structures were inherited from the pillaring of the iron-rich saponites that included in its structures organic compounds and also inorganic iron, such as iron 2 and iron 3, thence allowing to form through pillaring process all the organic compounds we have observed within. So then we proposed that these iron-rich saponites played a key role in the abiotic synthesis of amino acids. It's known that based on its capability to enable the alkylation of a lot of aromatic or compounds of heteroatoms, heterocycles, then we propose that the tryptophan we have observed can derive from the alkylation of indole that was observed also using deep UV fluorescence. Its alkylation with pyruvate, and if this reaction was followed by amination, then it could have result in the formation of this aromatic amino acids, which is usually not the first one to be considered to be formed in the classical Strecker reaction that are usually considered. So that's why we have proposed an alternative processes. All the compounds we looked at in this kind of models have high affinity in the condition that that prevails in the Atlantis massive under Locity. So you can see that based on this positive affinity, then indole, tryptophan, and pyruvate can easily form. And this is something I will not have time to tell you a lot today, but we also know that based on the kinetic inhibition of mesane Jill talked about in the previous talk, then we can favor the formation of abiotic aromatic compounds, including heterocycle, and that could be really the driver of all the diversity of organic synthesis at depths in ocean rocks. It confirms what has been introduced previously, that the tryptophan has by far, among amino acids, the larger chemical affinity for synthesis at mid-ocean rich fluids. So this is why we have proposed and considered this process seriously. But all this observation and model were confirmed by the observation we have continued to do on these samples. And first, TOF-SIMS analysis has revealed a larger amino acid diversity in that samples. For example, here you recognize the place we did all the analysis I showed you previously. But in addition to tryptophan, then we have also found the presence of methionine, tyrosine, phenylalanines. So at least around 10 different amino acids that were coexisting at that place. And perhaps most interestingly, scanning electron microscopy, but also X-ray absorption spectroscopy, show us that all the saponites and iron-rich saponites we were looking at were show that's a lot of iron and nickel sulfide would represent in spotting their surface, but also the whole volume of this secondary alteration phase. And this, as you can see here, using backscatter electron microscopy, but also secondary electron microscopy, you can see that this iron and nickel sulfate were all embedded by an organic carbon phase. And it's recalled what we have learned this morning about the messy polymers. So all the metal sulfide nanoparticles that can be encapsulated by carbonaceous matters. And all these tiny phases can be found associated with the saponites. So we wanted to look into more details at all these occurrences at the appropriate scales. So we did, once again, some focus ion beam sectioning, allowing us to observe, using transmission electron microscopy, where this iron and nickel sulfide were found. And you can see here, on one of the images we have collected, that these sulfides were really entrapped within the catalyzing iron-rich saponites. And at the place they were found, then we have found an enhanced disorder, but also an enhanced porosity, maybe supporting an additional catalytic role of this tiny sulfide at the local scales. So you can imagine that the joint occurrence of the abiotic amino acid and these iron nickel sulfides, as illustrated here with the TOF-SIMS imaging, showing you the diversity of the amino acids, but also as illustrated by the scanning, the transmission electron microscopy imaging, that this joint occurrence may help us, may lead us to postulate that we may have here a possibility to form some short peptide sequences with iron sulfur cluster naturally within the oceanic current. And that could happen very randomly, but also widely as soon as the rock is hydrothermally altered, because all these kind of compounds are really common paragenesis within the oceanic crust. So then, at least, if we cannot form what we such kind of peptides, we have here, based on the ion exchange capability of the iron-rich smectites, the possibility to drive really at the very local scales and very and nanometric one, some chemical gradient and non-equilibrium conditions. And so we can postulate that all this can be in favor of local abiotic organic synthesis, but also chemical disequilibria that can maybe be considered as some converting engine that would lead to some reaction in confined within nanopores of the oceanic crust. So I only had time to show you one example of the type of study we have performed this last year. I had, due to time reason, to skip the other type of mineral-assisted organic synthesis example we have published recently in the study of Svorna et al. But here you can see as an illustration how saponite, once again, in association with hematite, but also hydrocarnate and other hydrogen-producing secondary phase can form different type of abiotic organic compounds during their alteration in the oceanic crust. So we have provided this last year some examples of the potential of the Earth, of the modern one, for prebiotic chemistry, for chemistry of potential prebiotic interest through mineral-assisted organic synthesis. But I would like to finish and it first raise some interest for my Mars exploration, because here you can see on this map which show you the hydrothermal and exhumed altered subsurface deposits on Mars. You can see that all the white spots you have on these maps correspond to the occurrence of iron-rich saponite, which has really similar characteristics with the one we have characterized in the oceanic crust. So what we have done on the character on the potential of the modern Earth could also have implication for the exploration of Mars. But I would like to also finish this talk with taking a few minutes to talk about ancient rocks, because if the modern Mars surface or Earth subsurface can show you really exciting potential for abiotic synthesis, then all the Martian surface also and its subsurface can be explored through the study of Precambrian cratons that can document also the potential for abiotic organic synthesis. And I would like to show you one example we have done in collaboration with Barbara Sherwood-Lola on the Canadian cratons. And the rationale for such a study is that Precambrian fractures fluid analog systems, which were initially studies for the very ancient fluid, they were bearing, but also they are now studied for all the rocks that are hosting these fluids. All these systems, which are fracture controls, contain fluid that can sustain habitability, but also high energy gradients. And we have in these systems since a long time some low temperature water rock reactions that allow the formation of hydrogen through serpentinization, but also radiolysis. There is proof for abiotic organic synthesis, and these systems is efficient since million to billion years. So this is a site in comparison to the modern oceanic crust that is not so old in the rock record. Then this study of such a system, and especially systems that are accessible through deep minings, allow to get away from contamination and mixing with surface lives. So these are relevant analog to examine preservation of fluids, traces in rocks, and in which we can find potential biosignature in ancient rocks, but also in potential abiotic or organic synthesis process that may have been recorded since many times. As an illustration, I will show you some results we obtained on rocks that were drilled deep in the Kit Creek mines. So this is a low temperature systems, and the thermal history was really low temperature, so for the past 2 billion years, we expect this system not to be strongly thermally modified. What we have seen in those rocks, so this is drill sample, drill rock samples that comes from few kilometer deep in Kit Creeks. Here you can see what optical microscopy show you when you look at these rocks. So this is a large view. You have opaque minerals, but also you have alterations through fluid circulations. Well, you can well identify by following the fractures. And in all these rocks, we have seen, based on scanning electron microscopy, that all the opaque mineral forming these ancient rocks were in fact iron sulfide of different type. So you have pyrotite, but also pyrite, but among the form we have identified. So here it's a corresponding scanning electron imaging you can of the previous optical image I show you. And let me just provide you some result we have obtained in this area that is one isolated from alteration vein. when you look at this iron sulfide forming a large part of this rock and widely occurring in this Precambrian cratons, then you can see that we have different types of variously altered sulfides. So here are some, but also here are other types, and they look more altered, but their grayish appearance is related to the presence of organic carbons, the preparations made the organic cracks, so it's well identified on these pictures. But some of these sulfides were intermittently mixed and embedded with carbonaceous matter. The presence of altered sulfides were confirmed by TOF-SIMS imagings, and you can recognize here this well the form and the altered sulfide here, made of oxidized iron and oxidized sulfur, compared to this one only made of reduced sulfur. And TOF-SIMS also confirms the co-occurrence of organic compounds in close association with this iron and nickel iron sulfide. And what is interesting is that maybe here we have an example, another type, in addition to what I show you at the nanometric levels below the Atlantis Massif, another example of a chemical engine allow you to form through the association and the co-occurrence of iron sulfide and organic compounds, different type of abiotic organic compounds. So we have in such kind of systems of oxidative chemistry that is fueled by water radiolysis. And this happened in a high H2 producing reduced environment. So this is really a place where you have high redox and chemical gradients. So all these processes are the first allow to selectively affect iron sulfate. And these iron sulfates are found within all these rocks encapsulated in organic polymers. This is also supported by the presence of elemental sulfur that cover the surface of these iron sulfate. And all these things are covered by organic veins. So by continuing the exploration of modern and ancient systems, we may find clues and further evidence for the potential of Earth, but also maybe other planets, for organic synthesis driven by the variety of minerals we can naturally find in rocks. I thank you for your attention, and I am open to questions.
Thank you very much. So, I think we have time for maybe one short question.
Thank you for a very interesting talk, and especially interested in your final session. I find the part about the spatial association between the organic compounds and the iron and nickel sulfide. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you observe nano-sized particle, and sometimes relatively larger. And I have two questions. Firstly, do you think initially when these sulfides are formed, they are big or they are small?
So probably we are biased by the fact that Kid Creek is related to mining environment, and the ore is derived from all these hydrothermal sulfides. So we have here a place with a high accumulation of sulfide. What we can see more often in the oceanic crust is small occurrences of nanometric size iron and nickel sulfide, but also iron sulfide too. And this is there can be both primary and secondary minerals, and it depends on the history of the rocks. But we have sometimes the occurrence of this sulfide with a coating of organics, and sometimes they seem to form concomitantly with the organics compound. So it's an open question we have to work on.
Yeah, because I noticed you also observed the oxidized species of iron and sulfur at the same place. So I'm wondering whether this means the initially formed iron sulfide are serving as the sacrificial electron source as well as the catalyst to like a sacrifice itself and also do some redox conversion. so to convert organic compounds.
It's an open question here. We have proof for the dissolution of iron sulfides. We have a lot of pits. And maybe here, because of the radiolysis of water, we may have a reactive oxygen species that can enhance the oxidation of sulfur. But the in such kind of environment, really the interplay between iron, sulfur, and carbon will be a key question in the upcoming years, because we have probably a complex history during the hydrothermal interaction between these three elements, and we have to look into details on how both iron and sulfur can influence redox transformation, carbon transformation.
Both of them can do redox chemistry.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Since we're going to be going into the coffee break, it looks like we might have a couple more minutes. So if there's another question. Okay. Eric, all the way in the back. Huh? So please throw along.
Yes, thank you also for your talk. I wanted to ask you about the presence of minor elements, which you spend considerable time on in your written versions of some of this work, but you didn't have time for today. You often see apparently an important role for the formation of chromites or for the edges of garnets or other complex minerals. The reason I ask what your opinion is about the special role of minor elements is that we have prebiotic synthesis colleagues who try to do experiments in fluid phases where it's clear that the coordinating effects of different transition metals are very different for the selectivity of the directions of reactions. And it doesn't follow that we should be able to extrapolate things that we find in fluid phase to things that we find in mineral phases, but it would be useful at some point if we can take what is learned in each of these contexts and relate it, the different systems, to each other.
Yes, for sure. And first point is that it can also be useful when people are doing experiments to look at the solid phase so that we can better combine what we observe in the fluids and in natural systems. But let me just go on the system. Maybe the one you were talking about, but we, in fact, I found different kind of occurrence of abiotic organic compounds, and here it's an example. Let me show you around garnets. Oops. Here around garnets, and it's really weird because hydrogarnets, we know that its formation is accompanied by hydrogen productions, but we only found abiotic organic compounds close to hydrogarnet that were bearing chromiums. So, and chromiums present at rims at the border of the hydrogarnet seems to be an important factor. So we considered that local factors affecting hydrogen production, but also local catalysts, can be important for and to drive the diversity of compounds we have found, but we are far from having understood all the role of these different kind of parameters, and that's why I think experiments are now important with, for example, synthetic hydrogarnet, synthetic iron-rich saponite, and so on, just to see what can be the precursors and how we can improve rates, and also concerning the precursor and the role of all these aromatic hydrocarbon we have found can be also important for the formation of amino acids. So that's why I think now it's time for experiments, and we will be happy and interested to see how people doing experiment can handle such kind of questions.
Okay, so thank you very much. Let's thank our speakers one more time.